So I'm Giorgio Zicari, I'm a PhD student in Queen's University in Belfast in the group of Mauro Paternostro. So first of all, I would like to thank the organizer for giving me this opportunity to talk about my work. And this work has been done in collaboration with Mauro Paternostro, who is my supervisor in Belfast, and with Matteo Brunelli, who actually did his PhD in Belfast and now is a postdoc in Cambridge. And everything I'm So basically, this talk is going to be based on this paper that appeared on Physical Review Research. And so if you want to see more details about that, you can find it there, or you can ask questions, obviously. So let me start from briefly outlining what I'm going to talk about today. So I will introduce the entropy reduction in non-equilibrium systems, and I will focus on a system of non-Markovian harmonic oscillators. And we will assess whether or not initial correlation play a role in the entropy reduction rate. And eventually, I will draw the conclusions about this particular instance. So let me start from scratch. So we know from the second law of thermodynamics, well, that whenever the system undergoes a transformation from an initial state to a final state, the change in entropy is bounded, delta S is bounded by this inequality. So it's greater or equal to the integral from the initial, so along the path that connects the initial state to the final state of delta Q, which is the heat exchange between between the system and the environment over T, where T is the absolute temperature at which this exchange happens. And then from this, we can, so since the equality sign, basically the equal sign, holds for reversible processes, we can naturally define this quantity, the entropy reduction, which quantify the it's basically the quantify the quantity by which we fail to attain the reversibility bound. But since we are looking at non-equilibrium thermodynamics, we are rather interested in rates. So if we rearrange the previous equation, we can write down the S and dT, which is basically given by pi minus phi, where phi is the entropy flux, which is the entropy that is flowing from the system to the environment. And on the other hand, we have the entropy reduction rate, which is the entropy produced within the system. So it's something that basically characterizes intrinsically the process. So, but the first question we would like to assess is why is this quantity interesting for us? First of all, it's important for applications. We don't need to go to quantum to understand this, because so since there is a growing interest in quantum technologies, we can easily explain why pi, the entropy production rate, is something that is very important for us. So, for example, if we consider just a simple classical engine in which we have a system coupled to two baths, a hot bath and a cold bath, and there is some external agent performing work on our system. So usually in the normal operating regime, the heat is flowing from the hot bath to the cold bath. So in this case, we can simply apply the laws of thermodynamics and get simple equations for the conservation of energy and the conservation of entropy. And if we combine them, we can easily compute the efficiency for our engine. It turns out that the efficiency of this engine is basically given by some quantity that is basically the Carnot bound minus something that is proportional to the entropy reduction rate. So this means that the entropy reduction is basically quantifies the quantity by which we fail to attain the Carnot bound. So that's why minimization of pi is technologically desirable. On the other hand, there is another thing that is for which it is important to look at the entropy production. So it gives us a way to characterize the irreversibility of processes in open quantum systems. We know that the standard picture of quantum mechanics, so we usually have deal with closed systems. In this case, if the Hamilton is time independent, we have a unitary we have a unitary trans unitary evolution. In that case, we display reversibility. So in that case, if we attach the system to a a system of a finite number of bosonic modes, for example, we start seeing something else. There is periodicity in the observables, but if we take the limit in which the number of modes goes to infinity, then we get a truly irreversible dynamics if we look at the system. In this case, we have an open quantum system dynamics. In this case, it turns out that the entropy production rate might be something very, very important for characterizing the irreversibility of quantum phenomena. But let's start from the definition of an open quantum system. It's a system that is interacting with infinitely many degrees of freedom of the environment. So in general, we can express the Hamiltonian as a sum of the Hamiltonian of the system, the Hamiltonian of the environment, and the interaction between them. So usually we cannot handle all the information about the environment. So what we do is to trace out the environmental degrees of freedom, and we rely on a set of usual assumptions that are collectively known as Born-Markov approximation. So in that case, we can derive a first order differential equation, which is the so-called Lindblad-Masser equation. But what this has to do with the entropy production? So there is a traditional formulation of the entropy production for open system that basically dates back in the 70s, late 70s. In that case, the splitting that we have introduced earlier between pi and phi reads as follows. Basically, we have pi that is given by the derivative with respect to time of the relative entropy. In this case, if we work in the hypothesis of a quantum dynamical semigroup, so in the weak coupling, basically, pi is going to be a non-negative quantity as expected from classical results as well. On the other hand, we have phi, which is the entropy flux that it turns out to be proportional to the inverse of the temperature. But this approach provides a consistent theory for the entropy reduction rate, but there are obviously some drawbacks in the theory, and there are also some difficulties that are intrinsic to this formalism. So it's difficult to extend to multiple reservoirs, to non-equilibrium reservoirs like squeeze baths or diffusing baths that are very important for applications, and they're well known in quantum optics. And there is also another problem, which is the so-called zero temperature catastrophe, which means that whenever we go to our temp, the temperature is going to zero, the temperature of the bath is going to zero, we end up with an inconsistency of the theory in the sense that pi and phi, so the entropy reduction and the entropy flux, are ill-defined, while ds and dt is a meaningful quantity, it stays finite. So the question is, if there is this problem, is there a way out to overcome these issues? So one possible answer is the one that was provided by this paper by Giada Santos, Gabriel Landi, and Mauro Paternostro, in which they basically they came up with the idea of using some well-known methods coming from quantum optics to provide a consistent theory of the entropy production rate. So in this case, we can rely on a different definition of entropy. We do not use the von Neumann entropy, but the Wigner or any two entropies. In this case, we can treat carefully, for example, the zero temperature limit is also easier to deal with those circumstances that was mentioned earlier, like non-equilibrium reservoirs or multiple reservoirs. So this is the approach we used to investigate this system, which is the simplest non-trivial system we can consider for assessing the role of initial correlations. And since the interest is just that, it's just looking at initial correlation in the entropy reduction rate, we chose to have two harmonic oscillators. They are non-interactive, so there is nothing in the Hamiltonian that accounts for the interaction between them. And then we also assume that the system is perfectly symmetrical in the sense that we have two identical reservoirs. They are characterized by the same temperature and the same spectral properties. And then in this case, the dynamics is governed by a time local Masser equation that we'll show you now. So this is the Masser equation. And there are rates that depend on time, so they display some non-Markovian effects, and delta counts for diffusion, gamma for dissipation, and if we combine them, basically we have the incoherent loss or pumping in our system in non-Markovian setting. And these coefficients ultimately depend on the spectral density, which is basically the function that tells us how each subsystem is connected with each of the modes of the harmonic bath. So but our interest is to look at the initial correlations. So they are independent, but just the initial preparation can correlate them or entangle them. And indeed, we use phase-space methods to attack this problem. So since our dynamics is perfectly Gaussian, in the sense that the channel is Gaussian and the initial states are Gaussian as well, we can solve the dynamics in terms of first and second moments. Actually, since our Hamiltonian is time independent, we can just look at the covariance matrix, so the second moments, and the covariance matrix satisfies an equation that is in the Lyapunov form. We can use the phase-based formulas that was mentioned earlier. In this instance, it means that we can compute very easily just by using simple linear algebra, the entropy reduction rate at each instant of time t, provided that we know a, d that are time dependent, and sigma that basically is the solution of the Lyapunov equation. So if we solve the dynamics of the system, we can compute pi. And the other advantage of using Gaussian dynamics is that we have a parametrization of the initial state in terms of a handful of parameters, as we will see later. So now we can prepare the system using this covariance matrix in the standard form. So we have it's basically a block matrix in which each diagonal block accounts for the two modes, while the off-diagonal modes are accounting for the correlation between the two parts. We can basically express A, B, and C plus C minus in terms of four parameters. So A and B are given by S plus or minus D, and they are connected with the local purity of the bath. So S is basically the total energy of the system, or the two-mode system, and D is the asymmetry between the two modes, while C plus and C minus can be expressed in terms of G, which is connected to the global purity of the state, and there is another parameter lambda that accounts for the entanglement between the two parts. I didn't put the full formula because it's a bit too long, but this is the essence and the message I would like to deliver. So we can answer the initial question, are initial correlation relevant? The answer is yes. We can compare two curves, for example, one in which we have correlation between the two modes, and the other one in which we forcefully remove the correlation between the two modes. And we see that whenever we have a dynamics in which C plus and C minus is different to zero, we get a higher peak in the entropy reduction rate. It's also worth mentioning here that since we are dealing with a non-Markovian dynamics, we get this oscillating behavior, and locally the entropy reduction rate can get negative. Then we perform a systematic study of the parameters. So the idea behind it is very straightforward. So we got four different parameters to initialize the system. We can change one parameter at a time, and while we keep the other three fixed. For example, if we change G, we are basically modifying the global purity of the two-mode system. We are just acting on the off-diagonal blocks. If we change D, we are changing the asymmetry between the two modes, so on and so forth. For example, if we consider the numerical simulation, which we consider different values for G, we can, for example, consider the case in which we are dealing with the vacuum, which is the problematic the problematic example for in the von Neumann approach of energy reduction rate. So in this case, we have an oscillating behavior for the entropy reduction rate. But what it turns out is that if we take the case in which the initial state is characterized by G equal to one, which means that the state is globally pure, then in that case, the peak in the entropy reduction is the highest we can get. Then we can increase the temperature and we see that the effect of the Fermat noise is that the oscillations are dumped to zero. And in this case, we still have that the highest peak is reached when G is equal to one. So by increasing G, which means that we are reducing the global purity, then we get smaller smaller peak in the entropy reduction rate. And moreover, there is another thing that we need to take into account is that if we measure the initial entanglement in terms of entanglement negativity, we observe that by increasing the temperature, we go from a regime in which there is no sudden death of the entanglement to a regime in which there is a sudden death. So there is a detrimental effect of the thermal noise on the entanglement between the two modes. Then, we can consider a numerical simulation in which we consider different values for d. D equal to zero means that the two modes are perfectly symmetrical, and this is the case in which we get the highest peak in the entropy reduction rate. And then we pushed ourselves a bit further, and we consider random generation of initial states. And what we saw in this simulation is that whenever we, regardless of the initial state, the one that maximizes the entropy reduction rate, the one for which we get the highest peak in the entropy reduction rate, is the one characterized by G equal to one. This means that the global purity is equal to one. So then we investigate a bit further and we saw what happens to what if there is a dependence on the initial entanglement of the entropy reduction rate. In order to do that, we need to choose a proper figure of merit, and we chose pi max, which is the maximum in the entropy reduction rate and what happens in this case is that the more entanglement we input in our two mode state, the higher is the peak in the entropy reduction rate. In order to investigate better this issue, we actually consider different buffs, so different spectral properties for the reservoirs. So we took a rather general expression for the spectral density, which is in a continuous function of the omega of the frequency omega. So in this case, we chose different values for the ohmicity parameter and different values in different cutoffs. For example, the Lorentz-Rude cutoff or the exponential cutoff. But what it turns out is that the phenomenology we were observing earlier, it's still preserved. We get that the more entanglement we input, in this case, I'm considering the logarithm of the smallest eigenvalue, the partially or asymplectic eigenvalue of the partially transposed matrix. There is an algebraic dependence on the entanglement we input. So the more entanglement we input, the higher is the peak in the entropy reduction rate. And this regardless of the particular spectral density we are taking into account. The other question we wanted to address is whether these results hold also in the memoryless case, meaning the Markovian limit. So in order to do that, physically, we need to look at long time limit and the high temperature limit. What happens in this case is the two rates, delta minus gamma and delta plus gamma, that accounts for heating and cooling in our damped harmonic oscillators, get constant over time. And this means that we recover the Markovian limit. So we have a perfectly Markovian dynamics. In this this case, we can reproduce the same results as before. Obviously, in this case, the peak is reached in at time t equal to zero, and then there is a dissipative dynamics. And we have a similar phenomenology, even in terms of dependence on the initial entanglement, the entanglement we input, if we measure it in terms of nu minus, there is a proportionality between the entanglement we input and the peak in the maximum in the entropy, in the entropy production rate. We also compare what happens in terms of integrated quantities considering the Lorentz Strude cutoff. So we saw that the overall entropy reduction in the time window we are looking at the dynamics is basically greater in the case of non-Markovian dynamics. So just basically this is it. I can go to conclusions. So we assess that there is a role of initial correlations in the entropy production rate. And we also saw that we have also shown that the highest peak in the entropy production rate is reached when we consider globally pure state. And we show, considering different spectral properties of the buff, the peak in the entropy reduction rate is algebraically dependent on the entanglement we input. And so what we are currently investigating is whether these results still holds in the case of finite dimensional systems. So if we consider spin systems, and so far it seems that they do not hold anymore. And so if you want, and basically this is it. So if you want to have more information about this, you can look at the paper. And there is also a very extensive review about this topic that is going to appear on the Review of Modern Physics by Gabriel Landi and Mauro Paternostro on the entropy production rate from classical to quantum systems. And with this, I'm done. I thank you all for your attentions, and I'm more than happy to take questions if there is any. Thank you.
Thank you, Giorgio, for the very clear talk. I think there is a question coming in the chat. While this comes, maybe let me ask you a quick question. So you showed that in one of your numerics, you found that the entropy production is larger for non-Markovian evolutions than it was for Markovian evolutions. So could you comment on how general is this feature? It's kind of intriguing. Is it a general feature?
Yeah, it's a kind of intriguing. I don't know if it's general. Actually, I agree. It's something that we wouldn't expect somehow. So in the usual picture we have in mind whenever we consider non-Markovian systems is that you are in non-Markovian dynamics, what happens is that you are losing some information and then at some later point you are retrieving some of the information. So if you perform the integral, you would expect that there are some region in which the entropy reduction is positive and then negative, and then you would get an overall positive entropy reduction. So it's something counterintuitive, but this tells us that basically when we consider the Markovian limit, in which basically you're taking the cutoff going to the infinity, we are losing a lot of details in between. So there is something, especially at short times, it happens something that we cannot fully account for. So I don't know how general is this result, but it's something unexpected. Yeah, I agree with this.
Thanks. That's surely worth looking at. So the quick question that was in the chat is, for different initial states, could the trajectory of the evolution cross each other? So could you have a crossing trajectory?
For this dynamics, it doesn't happen. Actually, if you see, it doesn't happen, but also I think there is a strong impact of the temperature of the buff. So it depends on the temperature of the buff. For some instances, for example, if you see the zero temperature limit, which is quite pathological somehow, there is some crossing between the trajectory. So it depends.
Okay. Okay, thanks.
Usually when you deal with a finite temperature buff, it seems that there is no intersection between them.
Thank you. Perfect.